March 10th, 1989, Berlin, Germany. What goes best with a cup of coffee? Another cup. This morning's pot has its own burner. It sits faithfully to my left. A few hours from now, I will be on the road to Köln, Germany. Today's sky is gray. I'm alone in the breakfast room of a large hotel. I ate with Selby this morning. We've been doing this for the last few days. He's such a great man. It's an honor to be on the road with him, to be around him all the time, to see him work every night. It means a lot to me, everything. Ah, yes. We drink the coffee and we feel the isolation settle in. Picture yourself at the table, staring absently at a crack in the table. Your eyes a vacant lot for all the garbage that is lost and thrown away. All the people you knew, past experiences, 10 lifetimes of gray skies, a planet of rainstorms fill you. You are totally alone with yourself. You take a long walk through yourself without moving. You don't remember when it was when you sat down. Time doesn't exist for a little while. The isolation that we all feel. Sometimes it's so clearly defined that it becomes another entity altogether. It sits across from you and shares the empty space of shattered time. Freedom can be a vacant lot. It fills you with nothing and then leaves you to figure it out. Isolation keeps me together. All the hours spent in the van staring at the passing road. I wrap myself around myself. Isolated parts starving for isolated parts that are starving. We can only get so close. And in this truth, there's a rough, lean beauty, a pure line. Even when together, we are apart. I think that there are moments, instances of power, of time outside of time, moments that are truly larger than life. At first, I had problems with the isolation. I didn't understand it as truth. And I fought within myself and I tore myself up inside. Once I saw and understood the isolation, new doors immediately opened for me. The end of the line defines the line. At the end of the line, there you are alone. Life was a flash, a handshake in the dark. In the lonely room packed with people, there they are, there you are. Truth screaming in your face. Sometimes the night is a sharp punch in the guts. March 20, 1989, Amsterdam, Holland. Tonight is crawling by like a well-fed roach. Alone in my hotel room. Cheap town, Amsterdam is. Hash-dealing freaks staggering, their sales pitches mixed with coughs that rattle. One guy followed me into a bank. I contemplated a shot to the head, but you can't be doing that in a public place. You don't want to get into it with pigs in a place like this. That would be something, though, to dump a Dutch cop. The hotel here serves up the awesome coffee. I'm seeing the light. I'm feeling the great weight. I've been coming to this hotel since November of 1985, when I was speaking at the One World Poetry Festival. A lot of cool people were there. Jeffrey Lee Pierce, Lytton Kwesi Johnson, Zev. They were great. One morning I came into the lobby and there's Mufti from Einstürzende Neubauten asleep on the floor, waiting for a room to be opened for him. Tonight is a night off. It's getting on near midnight. The moon is full and shining down the canal in front of the hotel. It's good to be alone. Sometimes I wish the night would last forever. Daylight brings the static human confusion overload. Been having a hard time trying to keep from caving in on myself. I feel so hollow. I don't want to be with someone else. That's just another nowhere, another gesture, a lie. Sometimes life is such an old joke. Another night in some hotel room in some city in some country somewhere. I chain smoke nights like these. Small lit cubes, these rooms. The nights are the stitches that hold me together. All the faces have fallen away. I see no one in this dream. Isaac Hayes on the tape deck singing Walk On By. I used to play that when I would be feeling lonely. Now when I play it, I hear it differently. It's not as good. I've got to get out of this room and get some air. March 21st, 1989, Amsterdam, Holland. Walking from your hotel to the city center without getting hit by a car, a bike, or a streetcar is something of a triumph. I wonder how many tourists have been done in by the Flying Dutchman of old Amsterdam. I bet the residents of Amsterdam have a love-hate relationship with tourists. They love the money that the tourists bring into town and hate the rudeness just as much. This morning I was walking to the record stores and I heard a group of young men speaking English. They had surrounded a large group of pigeons and were kicking them to death. One said, "Look at them, they're eagles." Another said, "I wish I had my 22, I'd blow them all away." I tried to look as Dutch as possible as I walked away quickly. Tourists buying blocks of dog shit thinking it's hash, running back to their hotel rooms and smoking it up, thinking that this city is so cool to be able to buy this stuff right there in the street. Some Dutch guy with a pocket full of guilder, laughing his ass off, thanking the USA. He sees a dog taking a shit at an intersection and says in his best Southern Californian accent, "Hash, dude, awesome." The Dutch have mastered the deadpan reply. That's the one where they make you feel like an incredible asshole. No matter what you ask, you will be answered as if someone is reading to you from a book on Russian history. The more energy you put into a question or greeting, the more you will be halted by slow, measured speech, which often contains better grammar than you will ever possess. And if you make a joke, the Dutchman will retreat 10 big steps down the hallway of ultra-infinite cool. Back on the subject of the homicidal tendencies of the Dutch roadways. One thing I've noticed about the drivers, they have their eyes keenly and intensely focused on everything except what is directly in front of them. Today I heard a lot of beeping, resulting in bellows and shouts in French, German, English, and Spanish, none in Dutch. Yep, tourists all. Be careful, carefree travelers. It would be such a shame to send you home to Carbondale, Illinois, in an American Express Eurofun body bag. March 22, 1989, Nijmegen, Holland. Powering some grade B coffee in a graffiti-covered backstage room somewhere in Nijmegen. Cold in here, raining and dark outside. This place reminds me of the place I played in Australia a few months ago. There was this dressing room with all these dead cockroaches on the floor, and their little wings were scattered all over. Tonight the roach wings flap in my ear, crunchy, brittle, flying low, writing blues songs effortlessly. In the other room, the club is showing a live video of Black Flag. I hear the song Slip It In pound through the wall. Life pushes you and gets you all cut up, confuses and traps you. Nights like these, passing the time, waiting to get on stage and bleed in front of strangers, that's what I do. When I go on tours outside of the USA, the term back to the world keeps coming up in my thoughts. When I come off a tour and have to deal with people that I haven't spoken to in months, it becomes clear that I have nothing in common with them at all. It's as if I've stepped off a spaceship and the world outside of the tour is some alien planet. All I can do is be as cool as possible for as long as possible and get away as quickly as I can. I have nothing to do with them in the world they live in. The only place to go is back on tour, back to rooms like these. Here is better. Just getting on with it. What else is there? Nothing. Nothing for me, at least.